everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 15th of the BusinessX learning series, Invest, Scale, Value and Exit. Today's topic is on scaling up through franchising. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Sonali, and welcome, friends, and welcome to another edition with BusinessX. BusinessX is a part of Franchise India Group, the company which specializes in helping startups raise capital. And also we work with companies we are not looking to exit. Today is a special subject, very close to me, because I've been more known for franchising than any other part of our business. And I've been involved last 23 years in franchising through our company, Franchise India. And lately, we've been using franchising as a great scale strategy for startups because early stage companies today find it very difficult to sometimes attract capital, which is through private equity or I would say, or even kind of venture capital. And franchising can be very, very strategic for their growth cycle. And especially in India, where debt is very difficult to get. One, you don't get kind of a debt, and equity is also sometimes difficult. So there's a lot of early stage companies find it difficult how to scale. So franchising can become a phenomenal strategy. It is not a strategy which has not been done. I mean, it's done recently, but it has been for decades and decades. Early stage companies have used franchising as a great scale strategy. But before I go in, I'll just explain you what is the difference between a growth companies and scale. Growth are companies which would grow in their performance, market share, financial performance, and they have to proportionately put resources, which means that in the conventional classic style, I'll have to open up more offices, hire more people, then I will get to the next level. How can I grow my brand or my distribution or my top line without putting the equal number of resources, without deploying the same kind of a capital in proportion? And that's something businesses to me are scale businesses. And similarly, technology businesses are great scale businesses because they don't deploy the same number of resources and business multiplies in different markets. Franchising is also like that. I'll start with giving you an example of a company called Subway. If you really see Subway, they have only one company-owned store. One company-owned store and one training center in US, a very simple business model, a business which is very predictable, a business which is very standardized, a business which has a strong business, kind of a business modeling which creates value for franchisee, value for customer, a value for a franchisor. And if you're able to get that kind of a business model right, now the company is in 45,000 locations and spread in multiple continents, over 100 countries, and the valuation of the business is phenomenal. Now, how can you really see that your business can also be another Subway? And that's where I feel that there is a lot of good companies. And I can tell you, India also, we have done a lot of work. We work with about 8,000 different brands in different sizes. Most of them, I would say, are early stage companies. We've taken companies like a Ferns and Petals, a flower shop company, and now 350 stores. We have taken some smaller bakery companies, one single store, took it to multiple locations, and many examples. Even the recent example was a company which was a technology company, started offline stores, Lenskart. They were a technology company, started an offline store, franchise, and they worked with them in the early stage in their franchising. Now they bought 1,000 stores. So, and most of these companies, if you really go deep down, has used franchising as their scale strategy. But franchising also is a more careful capital, because now the investor you're getting is not like VCs, and I think VCs have their own problem, right? They are very high, hyper-growth, demanding structure. So when they VC or a private equity enters a company, they would like to see 3 to 4 years hyper growth. They're more driven from driving what I call the company's equity, right? So they want to really see quickly the company valuation going up, because they want to see that multiple of their valuation going up. But franchisees are different. They're investors who want return on capital. So they're very clearly written on dividends. They want really the businesses to perform. So it's a very different strategy. Here, one side, you're getting somebody to invest with you. You continue to maybe lose money. But by the time you can demonstrate to this investor and say, look, I'm improving your equity, your valuation is going up, they are fine, because they're not interested in the dividend. They want to look at how they entered at X value and they're now at X plus Y value. versus franchising is a different strategy. When a franchisee invests into a company, he wants a return after 3 months. He wants to see his business has been profitable. And in 3 to 4 years, in 2 to 3 years, he gets his money back. And then he starts making money. Now, fundamentally, how do you design the business model for both strategies is very different, right? So if I would say a business which cannot make money for franchisees in a short term, then I would say it would not work for franchising, would not work for them. So it's very important. You need to really see that you might not make, you know, I've seen companies which have not made the money themselves. A lot of companies which were VC funded or backed by a large capital, funding. And these companies were themselves not making money, but they made sure the franchisee make money. Lenskart was a classic example. First 3-4 years, they were not making money. As a company, they were not making money, but they made sure that each of the franchisee they had made money, right? So how do you really design the business model? How do you make sure that the franchisee, every single franchisee which is coming in, have relatively not having too much of patience? Franchisee comes with a 3-4-5 year horizon. And in these 3-4-5 year horizon, you have to return the capital. And also you need to really give them some kind of profitability on the business model. And then if you are able to demonstrate that, then there is so much to be really brought in, and you can attract so much of capital through these franchises. It's a responsible capital. That's where the starting point would be. So three things which you need to be ready before you even think about getting into franchising and using franchising as your scale strategy or your capital raise strategy. I would say three things you need to come in mind. One is the performance. How do you make sure that every single franchisee which comes to your network performs? And that's something which you need to really do that. Is the business model ready for performance? And it will be commercial success. And that's something which is very, very important. Second is resilience. How do you make it the business model ready for any adversity? Even in periods which are not so performing, even like things like this, how do you make sure that the franchisee is able to survive these kind of low periods? How you make that thing? And third is adaptability. How do you make the business model adaptable to different markets and different structures? And that's something which is very extremely important. And I've seen more and more companies, even funded organizations, look at Oyo, started with creating this through technology aggregation of hotels. And later they went into becoming a hotel management company and then used franchising as a strategy of growth. All their hotels, which they started taking on over, which was having a franchise contracts. Now, this was a great strategy for them to not only expand in India, but actually to go to about 50 plus countries. And today I was talking to somebody very senior in Oyo, and they were saying that fortunately for them, because they expanded franchising and used franchising as a scale up strategy and went to multiple countries, their India business was not performing. Their India business was very low. They're still trading at a 10-15%, but the China business, which is trading at 50-60%. So they're able to really compensate because they're spread in different markets. This is also another thing which franchising gives you. It hedges you because you are in multiple markets. Even if one market is not really responding in that manner, the other market would compensate you. So this is also another area of advantage when franchising gives you an opportunity to really go to multiple markets. So I'll now spend maybe next 25 odd minutes in terms of giving you a few things. One, how do you really plan yourself and strategize yourself for getting into franchising? That we will talk about it. Then I'll talk about 10 things which would make a franchising work. What are the 10 things if you really want to get into franchising? What is it, 1 to 10 things you need to really make sure that it works for you? Third, how do you attract capital from franchisees? How do you really get franchisees invest with you? What are the cycle and how do you define these cycles? When you're an early stage company, how do you attract that and what kind of mechanism would work? What new mid level and your new mature level? How do you really do that? And third, last point, which I will take, because most of the startups, early stage companies, when they come to us and when we talk about franchising, they say, would it be right to franchise? Is it going to be attractive enough for the future investors to look at it? Is my valuation going to increase, decrease? What makes franchise companies more valuable? And this is true. Actually, franchise companies are much more valuable, and I'll talk about it. I'll give you about 10 things which are must to really look at when you're building a franchise network and you're also building your company for a future valuation. What are the 10 things which you need to keep there? But before we start, also I see a lot of people already started writing in Q&A box. Please go out and write and introduce yourself on a Q&A box. What is the background? What do you do? I mean, are you looking to scale through franchising? What is the business model you have? Any industry you want to talk about? And any questions you have for me, just keep writing. In the last 5-7 minutes, I'll take all the questions. and we try to answer as many questions you have. So before we, I start jumping into franchising, I'll give you a little bit, what do I mean by scale? You know, and I divide scale into five by definition. S stands for the strategy. Franchising is a long-term strategy. It should not be looked at a short-term strategy. You cannot start because you don't have, at this stage, you're not able to attract a sophisticated capital and you start franchising just to cover up this. That's not the way it's done. Even if you get 5 franchisees, 10 franchisees on board, you have to live with them for the next 10 years. So it has to be a long-term strategy. It's not an interim strategy. It's not something which you really think that you will get into that. Other things you need to really see is that what is the timing for franchising? Are you really ready to get into franchising? Is economic position in the country or the industry you are participating is right at that moment? Is the consumer behavior and you have captured the predictability of the consumer behavior that your business model currently and in next 2 to 3 years not significantly going to change in the consumer behavior? And if yes, have we accommodated that change in our business model itself, or we will be able to accommodate? Because franchise businesses, it takes a lot of effort to change after once you've gone in, right? Imagine now for KFC to say that, look, we don't want to be a same brick and mortar store. We want to be a dark kitchens and things like that. It's not easy because they already invested into the conventional classic design. So how do we really make sure that business model is ready for future inventions? And these days, this is a disruption market. Almost everything changes very fast. So how do you really create and define what is going to be, how consumer is going to buy next 2 years, 3 years? So it's a long-term strategy. It needs a very careful planning on that. And a couple of things in strategy is very important. When you're talking about franchising, you need to really see how you are, how you really differentiate your offering. What is your differentiation of offering? I see a lot of me too businesses coming in and they start franchising and there is no clear advantage or a clear differentiation they would really bring in. Clarify and define your core values and purpose. That's very important because franchising, you are not only, taking your product and dieting, but you also bring in other partners who will run these businesses in different levels. Say, for example, I was a hyper-local brand. Now, hyper-local in any kind of services I'm doing. What is my core values and where is my, my approach and how I'm differentiated on that? That's very, very clearly to be defined. Define your core customer also. You cannot go everywhere. Clearly, you need to have very strong customer base defined and very strong focused target group defined. That's very important. And at least 3 to 5 years, clear defined strategy has to be in place. So this is where your S would come. So out of the scale, S, I would define the strategy, which is long term, and pick up these differentiation of your product, define your values and a larger purpose why you're doing it, and define your customer base. Go into very target group, very, very sharp target group and stay there. And stay focused. The C stands for the culture. Unless and until, if you're getting into franchising, you need to define your culture, what you really are as an organization. And also make sure that every single franchisee which comes in understand that culture, creates and connects with that culture. Because this is a lot of independent entrepreneurs who want to join with you. Unless and until they're sinking with the culture. And this is what I've seen with good franchise organizations. They're able to pass that kind of a culture experience to the new entrepreneurs which are coming in. Almost every company in US which has been very successful, and I've been fortunate to at least work with about 100 of them, almost every company would insist that you spend 15 to 20 days with them in their headquarters and go through the whole process. And that process is not just for training you, it's actually getting you in the culture of that organization. Because future investors don't like, I've seen Yum as a culture, McDonald's has a culture, Subway has a culture, and they can be very different to each other. Yum is very different. Yum has very different belief systems. McDonald's has a very different belief systems. Subway has a very a different belief systems. But there is a certain culture. When you are a part of it, you will have that kind of a culture flowing in. So they really invest on that. They put 15, 20, 30 days, sometimes in bigger programs. It is a 3-month training, a 4-month training. McDonald's does 6 months training for a regional owner, minimum 6 months training before they even put that. This is only the thing which they want to do is invest into the culture. Second is, what is your competitive advantage? You need to really see competition and dieting, and you need to spell out very clearly, communicate that very clearly so that your franchisees also start communicating further on that. What is your competitive advantage? And also define your core competence in terms of where is your core competence really lying in? And it has to be very clearly demonstrated to franchisees. Third, you need to create a very actionable plan and set accountability. A stands for actionable plan. You need to have a very strong actionable plan, very clear defined roles for as a company for you and also for your franchisee. That has to be very clearly with the timeline. So you need to know that first four quarters, how it is going to spell out. I call the three stages of franchisee. Dependent stage, where a franchisee doesn't know anything, is completely dependent on you. Then you call interdependent and then independent. And all these three stages, the strategies would be very, very different. So how do you really create? The C stands for culture, competitive advantage, and core competence. And third point is setting accountability and also actionable plan. The fourth point is essentially about the L stands for liquidity. It's very important. And I feel that the franchising, the biggest problem I've seen in last, especially 5 years, for a lot of franchisees going down was, I think, capitalization at both at the franchisee and a franchisor end. They are not capitalized. The business models are not designed in a manner that they are having adequate liquidity. And especially now, I've seen a lot of companies already tumbled and they failed in the last 6 months because of the liquidity issue. There was no liquidity. I mean, franchisees ran out of their working capital. They don't have working capital. Now they need fresh working capital to bring those businesses back. And the franchisor also doesn't have a liquidity. So a lot of chains would collapse in these times because they're not able to really get that. So how do you really predict your cash flow situation and how do you create your reserves to pass through these difficult times? And finally is execution. E stands for execution. It should be seamless. It should have intact your consumer experience. You need to bring in last mile control and you need to also create overall impact in the market. So how do you do and define these five things? By definition of scale, strategy, culture, actionable plan and accountability, liquidity and execution. So that's how you will be able to build your broader long-term strategy for your franchising growth. Now let's get into the second point, which is about the 10 things which you need to have to make your franchising work. You know, first is business modeling. How do you really put the business model in place? What is your business model, which would have a clear forecast for next 10 years and also would have been having enough room to change also. While you make a business model, which would run on the core principles for next 10 years, but you also have ability and flexibility to bring few changes in the product or a service. Because this is not a time where anybody can, no business in the world can say 10 years, this is going to be same. The consumer would react in the same manner. Answer is no. But how do you recreate nimbleness in the business model that you can change also, but you still need to have bring a predictability, right? You need to have a broader understanding what you stand for, right? So like, for example, Ferns & Bet is a good example, started with flowers. Very clearly, big focus on flowers. Flowers was largely gifting, very small portion on a self-consumption. And they thought that this is what the business is. They never thought that they're in business of flowers. They thought that they were in business of gifting. Anybody who wants to send a gift, send somebody greetings, they would use flowers as a medium. And suddenly they started seeing the people asking for now cakes for them. Now they evolved the business model. And actually first they integrated cakes within Ferns & Petal, which is the flower shops. And they started using cakes and they were using external vendors to source cakes and give cakes also, because people want flowers and cakes to be given. And now they've created another company called F&B Cakes, which is also now another 100 stores. And that business came absolutely complementing to that. A lot of their existing franchisees actually became the franchisee for cakes also, because it was very clearly complementing. So by the time the company stayed very tuned to understanding what they stand for, they were standing for anytime you want to gift somebody and want it to be delivered in another city, you will use Ferns & Petals. And anything you change, and tomorrow this changed from cakes to chocolates to something else, they would continue to evolve, right? So by the time they stay true to what they stand for. So understand your business model, what is a larger purpose you have, and define your business model around it. Second is define roles very clearly. You know, this is one of the areas which gets confusing at times. Who's going to do what? What is going to be your responsibility as a brand owner? What is the responsibility of franchisee? And it has to be absolutely defined and also communicated in a very transparent manner to the franchisee. So the franchisee understands what is his obligation and what is expected out of him. And he also knows what he can expect from the brand owner also. That's very clearly defining roles. Third is creating this overall, what I call interdependence. I see a lot of models after sometimes, there is no reason why a franchisee sees that I have any reasons to stay with the company, right? So the whole dependability is not there, you know. So is the franchisee dependent because technology he needs, customer acquisition he needs, supply chain he needs, whatever that critical point is, there is a time where a franchisee would see no value to continue with the company. And I've seen a lot of companies collapsing because there was no interdependency. So how do you really define that there is always a connecting point? Like in Subway, anywhere in the country you go, the supply chain is centralized, you have to get everything from Subway. And so well designed that the franchisee, even if it tries to go outside, would never be able to do that because he will not get the proprietary product. So a lot of proprietary products are supplied just by the company. So you have to really see carefully. It can be your vendor selection, vendor locking game. It's your technology, your customer acquisition, your supply chain, any critical parameter of that which creates interdependability so that the franchisee is always with you. The fourth point is capability development. How do you build your organizational capability to support franchisee? And it has to be very strong and simple. You don't have to be a confusing organization. You have to be rather simple. I call it a nucleus. Create a small nucleus so that it can show a strong support to the franchisee, but other franchisee doesn't have to go multiple places. It's a single window clearance for franchisee, and also a more proactive approach to drive the network rather than be reactive on the network. Now, the fifth point is process development. How do you really develop your process and bring standardization to everything you do? I think the simplest thing in the business of franchising, which works to me, is how do you make it idiot-proof? If you're able to make the business model idiot-proof, it is scalable. It can go into other markets. So spend a lot of effort and energy in the initial days to make the business model idiot-proof. So you don't need a specialized people to run it. It can be easily taken, easily learned, and easily duplicated. The sixth point is how do you do franchisee profiling and also do the market micro-market analysis. So profiling is very important, very sharp profiling. You need to really know who you really want. What kind of, we call four fits: strategic fit, financial fit, operational fit, and marketing fit. All these four fits are very important, but there is a critical fit. If I was fashion brand, I would say strategic location is a fit for me. Very importantly, location is very important. But if I was in, say, operationally heavy brand, like a food or anything else, then I need operational fit. Somebody has to have a lot of time to put in, and it doesn't mind putting in 14, 15 hours in the business. If I would have a large investment business, then I need a financial fit, somebody who has a strong financial commitment towards the business. If it was a business which needs a lot of go-to-market, it's a concept which needs a strong go-to-market, then I will put up a marketing fit. So depending on where, all four are important, but one is a critical fit. How do you really use that? Then seventh point is capitalization and forecast. I see a lot of companies start very well. I can give you many examples. In last 4 or 5 years, we've seen great startups coming in, and they were able to take them through franchising. And the first 1 or 2 years were good. As the network starts becoming more demanding, they need more money to support in marketing. They need more money in the people management, large teams structure, and so on and so forth. And they lack capital. And I come down to why it happens. But they lack capital, and they would not be able to support, and the whole network starts collapsing. So you need to really see what stage you need capitalization and where it is going to come from. Only selling franchisee might not bring in. You need to continually also raise capital to support the network. So, but you need to forecast what kind of capital at what stage you need to know. Because as your network becomes bigger, the support to the network also will need to be a much bigger. And at a certain stage, you might have to spend a little more to build the brand equity. Your marketing spend might have to increase. So you need to really see what is your capital requirement for supporting these franchisees. Eighth point is always do alpha beta test. Do a natural market test, get to a natural market, start a couple of franchisees there, test it out, and do another market which is a little distant market for you, and try to test that. Right? For one of the companies, we are now doing one opportunity in a metro, and one we've taken out of tier 3 or city, and we're testing it both. And we're seeing that how the business product makes everything would change. And learnings from that, we will try to bring in the business model and then go and scale the business. But first do your alpha beta test before you start scaling up. Don't go out and give 100 franchisees. Do first 3 or 4 franchisees, take a learning from them, and then go into the next level. Ninth point is, before you scale, you have to scale, but also consolidate. Continue to do that. Every year, go back and consolidate some parts of it So you might have entered wrong market, or you've not gone in the right structure, or you've not got the right franchisee. At that time, you need to really see that are you able to really go back and visit and consolidate your position. You might have to give some exits. Some franchisees have to go out of the market. So continue to do scale, consolidate, and also do deeper penetration. So franchising is all about, like, 7-Eleven runs 27,000 outlets only in Tokyo. That's what really matters to me. You know, in franchising, that's where the real value has been built. Because here you are able to create a strong entry barrier. 27,000 outlets of 7-Eleven only in city of Tokyo. Out of the 60,000 local convenience stores, this would run about 30% of that, which means almost every third Japanese driven in Tokyo, because everybody has to go to these stores, is actually coming to 7-Eleven. And that's where the strong value creation really happens. So we see in India, sometimes people spread thin. They don't really create these strong clusters. They don't create the entry barrier. There's one company which we're very proud of in Chennai. They started a salon called Naturals. And only in the city of Chennai, they were having 200 salons. Only one city. 200 salons only in one city obviously would create a strong entry barrier. The last point on the 10th point for me is audit, innovate, and implement. You need to continue to audit on a regular basis every 2 months or 3 months. Understand what is the consumer asking for, what is the consumer not getting from our services. And if that is need to be changed, then bring innovation, bring new product categories, and also then to go and implement it. And go back to test and measure, and then go back and implement this and that. So that's the cycle. So 10 points, just to summarize again, invest on business modeling, define roles and obligation, create an interdependence between franchisor and a franchisee, do your capability development as an organization, do your process development and standardization, define your franchise profiling, very, very clear profiling, capitalization and forecast, alpha beta test, test it in 2 or 3 markets before you start scaling up, scale and consolidate, and also deeper penetration. And finally is audit, innovate, and implement. Do it in this cycle. So this is what would be, I would call, the 10 points of making your franchising work. Now let's understand how the ways of getting into franchising. Franchising would have different models to go in the market. Currently we have unit franchising. Unit franchising can further be divided into franchisee owned, franchisee operated, and it can also be franchisee owned, company operated. In cases where company feels that I want to be in control of that, because say healthcare or education, where you want really the controls to be with you, then brand owners are choosing to do what I call franchisee owned, company operated. But this is also can be dangerous strategy if you don't have organizational capability to operate everywhere. A lot of young companies are attempting to do that because they feel that they just need financiers who would come and put money and they would operate the business. But it is asking for a very additional responsibility. And sometimes I think there are a lot of challenges happen and they are not able to do that. One of the companies I invested and we had the strategy of doing franchise owned, company operated, and the founder which I invested on was not ready to really support that. So we actually had to convert a few of the stores to franchisee owned, franchisee operated. And franchisee operated actually started doing extremely well. And all the stores which were run by the parent company which I was invested on, they were not able to do well. So we had to take a call to shut few stores because they were not able to manage well. So one has to really see what kind of your management capability is. Then only you need to take a strategy of franchisee owned, franchise company operated. On the overall other side, if you feel that you need a much bigger territory penetration and you need somebody who is able to develop your region for you, then you need to choose between area franchise and a master franchise. And we call the area developer also, where you get somebody who would develop the region. So you need to really see how you are able to define that. So franchising also, there is another few areas which on when you start doing franchising, as high as 40% of your money, which you get as a franchise fees, would be gone into just acquisition of a franchisee, right? And then you have another 40-50% being put on the support to the franchisee. You actually don't make any money in selling franchisee. And this is a mistake a lot of people do. In the early days, when you get sell franchisees, you just think that the franchisee, selling franchisee is actually making money. Actually, no. If that was a business model, sooner or later, it will collapse. Sooner or later, you will run out of gas because your cost of acquisition and cost of service would take away almost everything from you. Good companies, in the initial stage, make sure that they come out of that cycle, and as their franchisees start performing, their acquisition cost would come down, and at the mature level, it will come down to even further. Today, mature companies don't need to spend that same money to acquire that, and then you will have maybe a little bit margin on your franchise. But the real money comes from the royalties or the supply chain margins which you have. That's where you make money. I know a school chain, which now runs about 1,200 schools. The money they make is not really selling franchise. They make money out of the supplies to the school. Every kid who joins in, and out of 1,200 schools with about 100 kids everywhere, so it's a lot of kids available. I think every single year they need to buy a new pack, and that pack would make a lot of money. So ask yourself, what is your recurring revenues which are going to come in, and how soon this would start trading? So at the early stage, I see the companies might do well, but really on the value really comes in builds when you hit the maturity, when you have a business which is creating residual incomes for you. Now let's understand a lot of myths in the market that if you franchise, then investors don't like it, the value is not built, you don't get the same kind of valuation. On the contrary, it's other way around. You get much more valuation, and I'll give you some answers on that. And this is on the principles of investment. But there are other things which are very important, which sometimes investors don't see, and that's why they don't appreciate franchise businesses. So I'll give you about 10 points again. If you really want to start franchising as a long-term strategy for you, and you also want to build your value in the business, these 10 points are very important. Some are inherent to franchising, and some you need to really focus on and design it in a manner that when tomorrow, when you're sitting across a big investor, you're able to demonstrate that why your business is so valuable and why they should invest with you. So first point is asset light. You are asset light company. So asset light is the buzzword which every investor likes. Franchising is an asset light business. You don't put your own capital. It works on OPM principle, other people money, and people put money as your franchisees, but actually sell your brand. So your brand is expanding everywhere. So like Subway is a 45,000 restaurant company, but just owning one restaurant of their own. So it's a asset light model. It's a phenomenal model. Everybody is having Subway sandwiches globally, but actually they own one single store. It's a good model. So asset light is a fun structure. Second, it becomes a better bottom line. You know, fundamentally, because you have lesser cost, so everything really comes to you as a good bottom line, especially if you are a big royalty generator, you have a very strong bottom line company. So people like good bottom line. The most valuable businesses are businesses which are more profitable, right? And this only definition of building value in any company is profitability. There is no other way. There is no other way. There is no other maths. Eventually, sooner or later, the only denominator for the great valuation for a company is the profits you generate. So if the profitability is much better in this business. Third is predictable revenues. If you are able to show predictable revenues over next 5 to 10 years, that this is the kind of revenues which would continue to come, investors love it, because that's where real value has been built. The problem happens with a lot of franchise companies which don't have predictable revenues. They are not able to build that. And some models are wrongly designed, and the models don't give you that. Some models are great. I've seen models which have fixed royalty structures. They get small royalty, but the fixed royalty coming in. And this is automated structure. They pick up the royalty every 7th or 8th from the franchisee, and there is a control mechanism which is well defined. So if you are able to show predictable revenues which would continue to come, you are more valuable. Your market penetration, again, if you're spread thin, and that's not interesting, if you are penetrated very well in a particular market that you've created entry barrier, then also business becomes much more valuable. So you need to really be a Mongenies in Bombay, where you are very, very clearly penetrated market. You have a certain market share. And so a lot of good companies have done that well. So they have franchise businesses, but they have gone and created huge market entry barriers. And that's where the value would really be strong for them. But like Dr. Lal Path Lab, the penetration in Delhi was very, very strong. And that's why it created a great value for them. Your contractual structure with the franchisee. This is very careful, because end of the day, you would be sitting on hundreds of contracts, and any investor which comes in can get complexity if the contracts are not well defined, or they're very complex in nature, or there are multiple changes in that, or this doesn't have assignment rights. Tomorrow, if I want to sell the business, can I novenate this entire business to somebody else? All that is very clearly to be defined. You need to really see that you are not contractually complex, because in the days you have hundreds of relationships and which are binded by contracts. It has to be very solid, and it has to be well defined. so that when anybody really evaluates your business, is able to see that this is contractually well structured. Finally, scalability. You know, any franchise business which really wants to value should have a scalable business model. It can go to not only one market, but can travel to multiple markets. And that brings in a great amount of future valuation being discounted. So if I was, say, today at 200 stores, and I can demonstrate that this 200 stores can become 2,000 stores, and I can travel to multiple markets, then there is a greater value to be done. Then constant improvement and margins and bottom line. That's very important. In the next 3 to 4, 5 years, as your franchise network would continue to grow, how do you demonstrate to your investors that your margins are going to grow better? And that's something which also is very important. You know, so how do you really improve your margins over the time? And what are the changes which needs to be done over 3 to 4 years, which can demonstrate better margins and profitability for the business model? And that's also very important. And next step is brand equity and upkeep. Sometimes when you expand through franchising, and if you have kept the brand intact and the upkeep of the brand is also very strong, the consumer experience at every single franchisee is intact and well controlled, that also is a part of valuation. I've seen, again, a lot of investors at a last have declined investing into businesses because they said that the brand was not very kept well, and it started declining, and the experience and the ratings and everything else also have gone down. So how do you really keep that intact? That's very important. And it's one of the reasons why some companies don't franchise, because they feel that the quality would not be intact. Actually, the truth is they have no mechanism to really audit and control that quality. How do you really bring controls over your network is very important part of it. Second last point is, how do you have a proprietary product and stickiness of a franchisee to stay with you? Sometimes I've evaluated businesses and I feel that there was nothing which tells me that the franchisee would stay with you. The franchisee, maybe at a certain level, would leave the network. What is the stickiness? How do you demonstrate that you have something which franchisee would always have to ask from you? What is the proprietary value, and what is a proprietary product which you have, and brings in a huge amount of stickiness? And finally, the leadership team and the team ability to continue to build the network. As a founder, if you are a founder of the company and you build some team, which you know when the investment comes in, can able to clearly see the kind of leadership team you've built in. Great examples are companies like NIIT, Aptech, strong leadership teams. So whenever the company's early investors came into the business and the company got listed, and all these times they saw a very strong foundational teams. They might not be business had its ups and downs, and a lot of changes really happened, but the team was so strong and so capable, so they were able to put the valuation up. So franchise companies can be strong valued if you are able to maintain these 10 points and continue to really work on that. And then you will be much better off in terms of presenting it to a potential investor. So this was a strategy for today. And idea was to share with you that how franchising, particularly in these times, can be a phenomenal strategy for scaling up your business. And it is also a good strategy to raise capital and continue to fuel your growth. But it is a careful strategy. It's a responsible strategy. You need to really think through that franchisee comes with a short-term mindset. Now, do you be able to deliver him the required profitability within that period? And also, overall sustainability of network is there. So over to you, Sonali, for any questions you see for me, and then we can...
Thank you so much for another wonderful session, Gaurav sir, and for sharing your valuable insights with us. So we do have quite a few questions lined up with us. The first question is from Kiran. The question is, my name is Kiran from Medfile. We are into hospital management system and lab management systems, and I want to go into franchise model. I'm presently in Hyderabad and would like to move to other tier 2 and tier 3 towns across India.
Absolutely. I think a very, very good segment and very good niche you've built in. Very strong category to really get into that. Specialized services and a very clearly B2B kind of franchise model. And India lacks these kind of franchise models. They're very scalable, highly profitable, very strong predictability. As I said, it's a very contractual. Once you get a few contracts with hospitals, then you are there. And so I would say anything which has a B2B supply and a long-term contractual valuations, it's a good businesses, very, very good businesses. And you should really franchise the business.
Another follow-up question from Kiran itself is, how can I work with Franchise India for my business, for raising capital as well as growing my franchising?
I would say grow franchising first, just park a little bit raising capital at this moment, because I feel unless and until there is a immediate requirement before even you franchise, you need to raise capital to set few things, then is a different case. But if you are at this stage only looking for growth, and franchising is a good way, don't dilute your equity at this moment. Go to a reasonable size, try to create contracts directly with you. Fulfillment should be done by the franchisee. With you, and at that level, when the business has certain size and share, and you have say 100 hospitals, 150 hospitals under management, raise equity, and raising equity is also very important. A lot of people want to raise money, but they don't have a very strong reason why you want to raise, how much you want to raise, where you want to deploy, because capital raising is also a responsibility. The first question anybody would like to ask: what are you going to use with my money for? And how fast are you going to use it to create returns for you and for me, right? So that's what the question people don't get answer on, you know? So capital wants to be sweat out faster. You know, you need to sweat out fast. You need to use that fast and create returns for all stakeholders. But that reasoning has to be very important for people. Yeah.
Absolutely. So the next question is, we are into organic biopesticides manufacturing and marketing companies since 1997, but we are not able to scale up. We want to scale up and exit. Please guide.
It's in biopesticide.
Biopesticides.
So manufacturing company, so we need to really see biopesticide if you want to scale up through distribution, or you want to set up these OEMs, which are also manufacturing franchisees across market. And that's a good opportunity to really set up these smaller franchise businesses where you would get licensed to produce and distribute. That can be a good model to be done. But I would like to really go deeper into your business model and then I can advise you.
Right. The next question is from Mr. Vinod. He says, as a founder, how can I market our product at the local level?
Yeah, you can. Obviously, this question is generic in terms of how you can market, but there is another question.
Yes, we do have another question from Mr. Vinod. He says, I'm in food business. We are planning for it. So apart from selling franchisee, we are going to sell or supply masala packets for our product. I'm trying to understand, but I'm not a manufacturer. So doing packaging of masala and to sell the franchisee, how does it work? Do I need to get any manufacturing certification or set expiry date for our masala packet?
Yeah, you don't have to do that. I think this would come from the OEM. You would contract manufacture your masalas. And just for your information, there is no food company I know which has their own manufacturing for supply chain. They always contract with leading companies. Like the biggest supplier for McDonald's is a company called Vista Foods. Now Vista, Weber Foods, and then there's a Cremica. These companies are big companies for HoReCa. And they are big time and strong contracts with McDonald's. They share proprietary recipes. So recipe they would have, they would only do it for McDonald's and then supply their franchisees. So you can do a very strong vendor contract. You can go to any masala company, create your own proprietary masala, which is only limited to you and to be supplied entirely. All the licenses and all the FSSI and all the other packaging rights have to be done by the OEM who's supplying you. So it's a big mature market now. But yes, you're right. If you control that product supply, and then you're very successful.
Right. And Sheetal Sagar asks, how investors do valuation of a business? So Sheetal, this is the perfect question for our next session. So our next session will actually be on business valuation and everything revolving around it. So if you're interested to know more about that, so please join us next Saturday at 3 p.m. for this session.
Yeah, this session is actually on valuation. So we do 4 sessions. Invest, scale, value, and exit. So we talk about investment. How do you invest into different businesses, asset class, and so on and so forth. We talk about scaling up. Today, we took a special topic, which is closer to me, franchising, but we talk about scaling up. Otherwise, how do you scale your businesses? And we talk about valuation, which is the next week. And then we talk about exit. If you want to sell your business and you want a good exit, or you want to exit for profit, or you are distressed at an asset and you want to come out of it, how do you really plan your exit?
Perfect. So I think with this, we'll just wrap up our Q&A session. So Gaurav sir, if you can, yes.
My email ID, if anybody has questions, especially on a franchise side, if you feel that anything I can answer for people or anything else which you feel you have suggestion on, please reach out to me directly. It's a gm@gauravmare.com.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir. Thank you for another wonderful session and for always helping and guiding our members for all topics related to invest, scale, value and exit. Anything you would like to say in the end?
No, good. I think it's a good session. It's closer to what I do. And this was simple. Franchising is a simple topic for me. You can wake me up at 2 o'clock in the night and then for 4 hours I can do. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you to all our attendees for your time. And we really hope we were able to add some value to your lives through this session. And we'll see you next Saturday at 3 p.m. for another session, which will all be about business valuation and how to value your business, how investors determine the value of your business. So if you're interested, please join us.